certain busybody who can never keep a secret. Whatever the weather, it's always therapeutic to be out in the peace and tranquility of the Yorkshire countryside. But when I meet the village gossip, it might not be quite so quiet. Hey, Zach?
When all's said and done, Michael, it very rarely is. I think you'll find her yakking away outside the village shop.
The woman I'm after is no stranger to soap sagas. Before she arrived in Emmerdale, she carried on in Coronation Street. And her other address was Brookside Close, Liverpool. Thanks for the lift, Zach.
See you later, Mike.
The subject of our story grew up in Manchester and made her stage debut at the tender age of 4. These days she's got more rabbit than Seth Armstrong after a hard night's poaching.
They're right there, Michael. She's out at the front if you want to come through.
Oh, right, thank you. Right now she's recording a scene outside the post office with the evil Eric Pollard. I'm going to have to break it up.
Betty, don't get a hold of just yet. I've got an idea.
Well, if it's about an assassination, I'm your woman.
What sort of Christmassy things were you wanting?
Well, you know, the usual. Peaches in brandy, orange and lemon slices, chocolate liqueurs shaped like little bottles, and a nice box of dates with one of them harpoons in.
I tell you what, we can add something else to that list as well. Because I've just thought of something, a bit of news I can't hold in any longer.
Okay.
No, Betty, alias Paula Tilbrook, tonight this is your life.
Yeah!
Is this a joke?
No, this is really it. It's a piece of gossip that didn't reach you, I'm afraid. I know Betty wouldn't like it. A lot of people are going to talk about you now. And just to show they really love you, a large turnout of friends, colleagues and family, including your cousins, Roy Humes and Ailsa Walters, your daughter, Gaynor, and with his wife, Leslie, and the children, Joe, Laura and Amy, your son, Greg. Well, Paula Tilbrook, this is your life, and you've been Emmerdale's resident chatterbox since you made your first appearance in the Woolpack ordering a sweet sherry 6 years ago. Your career on stage and screen has spanned more than 40 years. And here are a few key moments from your TV times.
It's a lot younger then.
Afternoon, miss. Another sweet sherry, please.
I heard you speak tonight, Mr. Roberts. And we need men of your mettle.
Yeah, but you've got to have the stomach for it, you see.
You've got the stomach for it, Mr. Roberts.
This place.
I have it on good authority that there's a massive picture of Betty hanging in Kuwait to deter Iraqis from invading again.
Seth Armstrong, you said you were going to toilet.
Ah, but fair's fair, love. I didn't say which toilet.
What time do you call this?
I reserve my defence.
Do you know it's Wednesday morning?
Never. Your calendar's fast.
No. Have you used an electric typewriter before?
No.
Well, the keyboard is the same as manual, but this button is your carriage return.
Looks like you're gonna splash out, Eric. Oh, I am sorry, Eric.
Mr.
Well, the Woolpack and Cathy's Diner are empty tonight because they're all here, your friends, aww, the cast of Emmerdale. Sandra Burrows is Kathy Glover. You employ Paula in the diner. Is she a great asset?
Oh, she is the best. So funny, so adorable. But most of all, as Paula, so caring. I mean, Paula and I get sort of told off on set as a terrible twins because, you know, we're sort of always talking. Normally about things going on in our personal lives, and Paula, you're like a mum to me. But there's a little secret.
Another one?
Have you ever... Paula, just tell everyone why you kind of suddenly disappear from the set through to the back kitchen. Is it your sweet tooth?
Are you inferring that I might be stealing the cakes out of the fridge in France?
You're fired.
Now, Chris Chattel, a few words from you and kind ones, please.
He's not capable.
That hurts me to say anything kind about Paula. Because she's never said a kind word to me, ever. But I will say three things. Naughtiness. Great humour. And even more naughtiness. And I love her.
Now, Stan Richards' gamekeeper Seth lives with Betty, his wartime sweetheart. Is it nice to have a spot of on-screen passion?
Well, the unfortunately, since Paul and I first met, all we've done is laugh together. And as for passion, I think once we got on the side of the bed in our night attire to have a discussion, and if you can imagine anything less erotic than Seth then climbing into bed in his cap, then I don't think a lot of passion going, but she's lovely.
Well, Paula, over the years you've worked with some big names. One of them is anxious to know how you're diddling, the sage of Knotty Ash himself, Ken Dodd.
Hello, my dear. Old Farmer Doddy here from Knotty Ash Farm, just on the other side of the hill from Emmerdale. Who are? Excuse me, I've been muck spreading. Congratulations, Paula, on your wonderful evening of celebration. I hope you're having an absolutely fabulous time. I remember with a great feeling of consciousness working with you on our great radio shows. How discommoderating it was, Mrs., to work with a real lady actress, a professional. You never said no. That we asked you to play. Oh, that wonderful laugh. That wonderful, wonderful laugh. You laughed at the jokes. You laughed at the people. You even laughed when I was singing. So, this is your life so far, Paula. And I hope it continues to be a life full of happiness, full of good health and laughter.
Okay, back to scene one. You were born in Salford, Lancashire on January the 16th, the only child of James Tilbrook, a miller foreman at Churchill's heavy engineering factory, and his wife, Olive.
Oh,
you grow up in the family home in Newton Road, Broadheath. Oh. And there you are, clutching a woolly vegetable. Your first stage experience was at the age of four in a Sunday school play. You were hooked at once, weren't you?
Yeah, I do remember that. I remember it must have been a panto, because I played Jill and a little boy playing Jack, and I remember standing in the wings and what seemed like an enormous hand, which must have been an adult, with a hand on our backs. And I remember thinking, I wish you'd take that hand away. Just do it to him. I know when I've got to go on.
Well, you go to Sunderland Road Primary School in Broadheath and then Wellington Road School. It's World War II and Manchester, with its heavy industry, is a target for German bombers. Your schooling is constantly disrupted by air raids. The authorities offer to evacuate you to the countryside, but your family decides to stick it out and you brave the bombs. In one German raid, the local sweet factory got a direct hit, didn't it?
Yes, it was wonderful, because we usually just collected shrapnel from the wreck, you know. But this particular morning, it was wonderful because there was toffees there. And I'm afraid, like I am now, Melandra, I went gathering toffees. And I hope it gets hit again tomorrow night.
Well, you leave school at the age of 14 and you join the Altrincham Electricity Supply Company as an office junior. Away from work, you become a keen member of the Broadheath Co-op's drama group.
And we all knew that one day, Paula, your talent would pay dividends.
They shared the stage with you then, Norman Smethurst, Derek Cardin, Ken Bryant and Roy Smith.
Oh, I don't believe it!
Now, Derek, Paula was serious about her acting.
Yes, very much so. In actual fact, in the early days, you were very dedicated to your work. And you probably remember in the kitchen, where we used to do teas and toasted tea cakes. And amongst those, you were learning your lines while the rest of us were laughing about in the main room.
You weren't dedicated.
Your professionalism was showing through just even then. And you made every rehearsal seem like a night out, you did.
Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Right.
Thank you. Just as I
see you later.
When you're 21, you marry Les Hall, an electrical engineer you'd met at work. The ceremony takes place at Broadheath Congregational Church on May the 30th, 1952. You set up home in Stockport Road in Timperley, and Gregory is born in November 1953. Gaynor arrives 4 years later. And thanks to Gaynor, we've come across some early home movies shot by Les of you and the children.
Oh, God. Who is this? Oh, yeah.
Greg, at home, your mother is the life and soul of the party.
Yes, so I'm indebted to my father for giving me my engineering background, but to my mother for giving me my sense of humour and my imagination, thank you. But also for teaching me over the years how words come into the language. For instance, a sedan chair. Why is a sedan chair called a sedan chair?
Because you sedan in it.
And church cloisters.
Well, it's because they close together.
But my favourite, I think, is statue.
Because when you're walking along, you see this figure and you say, is statue?
And I think we say goodnight.
Sorry about that.
Well, as your children are growing up, you join the local drama group at the Garrick Theatre Club in Altrincham. You're beginning to sound like a strolling player.
I was proud to help you turn professional.
The familiar voice of George Barford in The Archers, your old friend Graham Roberts.
Yes.
For Graham, Paula's talents stood out.
Indeed they did, Michael, they did. At that, I learnt as a young director in the theatre that there weren't amateurs and pros, there were just good actors and bad ones. And I knew I've got a good one with this one. I knew that you had to turn pro.
And I said, you know, come on, Paula, you can do it. You can, this is good. Oh, no, I've got the children. I've got all this to do, she said. And I went on and on and on at her, you know, about, you can't waste this. You've got to use it. Now, really, really use it. And I went on to such extent, she just turned to me and went, don't push it, Alice. She had to start, didn't you?
Yes.
I'm glad you did.
Thank
she
you.
She got it right. That's what this girl did. Graham, thank
Bless
you very
you.
Much. Well, another friend who appeared with you at the Garrick Theatre was Ruth Metcalf. And Ruth, you've never forgotten the experience?
No, when I joined the Garrick as a young actress, one of the first things I did with Paula was the cabaret. And this cabaret was performed in front of an audience of Garrick actors, and I was rather nervous. And anyway, Paula gave me these words of comfort. Don't worry, love, she said. It's only just like being thrown to lions.
Very helpful. In 1970, you appear in Hay Fever at the Manchester Library Theatre, and your professional career takes off. But then in 1973, your husband Les is involved in a major accident. He's working in an electricity substation when there's a huge explosion. Les is hit by 25,000 volts and rushed to hospital. You were called to his bedside.
I remember walking down the ward, and I saw this man in a bed, and his face was completely black. And his head was about this big, and I remember thinking, God, he's in a bad way. And I walked past, and the nurse got hold of my shoulder and pulled me back, and I realised it was Les. It's what the blast had done to him, yes.
Well, he is eventually discharged from hospital and returns to work, but the side effects of the accident means he has to take early retirement. But your acting gives you the ability to carry on during Les's illness. You appear in repertory theatres all over Britain. In 1975, at Bolton's Octagon Theatre, in All in Good Time, you play the mother of someone you meet again later in Brookside Close. And over now to that old friend who's about to go on stage for the first night of her
Thank
latest
you.
Play, Anna Keaveney.
Hi, Paula. While you're partying up there, I've got an opening night, which is why Gordon's with me. As he's been with me every opening night since you gave him to me, along with his little surprise. Do you remember All in Good Time at the Octagon when I went down with German measles? Nobody else could fit into the wedding dress, so I had to go on. And every time I thought I was going to drop, your hand was there in the middle of my back, holding me up. On my very first radio, and you and Alfred Bradley made everybody line up and shake my hand and wish me luck. And then Brookside. Well, I think they knew they'd made a big mistake putting the two of us together. Arctic conditions in the middle of Liverpool. And you and I totally hysterical. Nobody has ever made me laugh like you do. You're a great landlady as well. Lovely to stay with you. And Gordon, as you can see, has still got his little surprise.
My God.
In 1976, as a change from being a good friend, you play one of the ugly sisters at the Oldham Coliseum.
And that's when we discovered that all that glitters is not gold.
He ran the Oldham Coliseum at the time and played the other ugly sister, yeah. John Jardine.
Oh.
Well, John, don't look behind you. Just tell us the story.
I have waited years.
Oh, I shall see my solicitor, Freeman, Hardy and Willis.
Yes, indeed. Now, listen, we did Cinderella and we had the ponies. And we had the coach.
Yeah.
We decorated it with just Christmas tinsel that you used to get from Woolies, didn't we? And we used to stable the ponies at the back of the theatre in the scene dock, and the coach used to stay with them overnight. And you used to tease me, I know, during rehearsal, you used to say, Johnny, don't worry. If the ponies have an accident, I will run on with a handful of glitter and cover it. Nobody will know it's there. I said, thank you very much. Anyway, about 3 weeks into the run, we're in our dressing room. Yes, we shared a dressing room. That's another story. And the stage manager knocked on the door and said, Mr. Jardine, I'm so sorry, but overnight, the ponies have broken out of their pen and they've eaten all the tinsel off the coach. On go the ponies, on goes the coach, and yes, of course, the pony obliged Centre Stage. And I was getting absolutely furious, and she grabbed my arm and she said, "Look, Johnny, the little darlings have done it for themselves." It was all glitters.
Well, another success in 1976 was in the Brian Glover play Summer Season. 2 years later, you're at the Coliseum, Oldham, in the stage premiere of the film hit Kez.
And I was your son.
He's grown up since, here with his wife, Jeanette Beverly, Coronation Street's Kevin Webster, Michael Lavelle. Michael, you were only 13 at the time.
13, yeah, and it's this thing she's got. It's like being thrown to the lions. Can you imagine being 13 and working with this one? But I tell you what, if it wasn't for you and making it so enjoyable, I wouldn't have stuck at the job at all. You know, I mean, you're there, it's your first job, and it's like, am I going to like this? Am I not going to like this? I'm working with you. You could not like it. It was just like, yeah, I want to be an actor, thanks to you.
Thank you for all the pleasure you've given everybody.
No, Paula, you are. You're more than that. I mean, you've been a friend now since then for 20-odd years.
Jeanette, you worked with Paula in the TV comedy Sharon Nelsie.
I did, yes. She came into it for one episode, but she was so brilliant, the writer said, that's it, we have to write her in again. And I was 17 and thought it was cool. I had a flat in London. And she started manipulating me then. And she said, I haven't got anywhere to stay. Could I stay with you? And what she was really doing was keeping an eye on me while I was in London. She is always, always there when I need her. Mm. And my kids adore her.
Thank you both. Thank The other star of Sharon and Elsie also appeared with you in the 1987 stage hit Effie's Burning. And here's a message from Bridget Forsyth.
Hello, Paula. We first worked together on Sharon and Elsie. But of course, the thing I really remember you for is your portrayal of Effie in Effie's Burning. And we got the most amazing notices for it, especially you. And I will never forget you in that. I hope you're having an amazing evening, and I hope you go on for years entertaining millions of people. Bye. Bye.
And the writer of Effie's Burning is here, Valerie Windsor. Wow. Now, while your career goes from success to success, there is sadness at home. 10 years after his accident, your husband Les was diagnosed as suffering from premature Alzheimer's disease. You devise a rota so that you, Greg and Gaynor, can give Les 24-hour care from the family. But eventually, in 1985, he died. Now, Paula, you've never stopped working on stage and screen, and you've also been a regular on what some performers enjoy most, the radio. Over 100 plays for Radio 4, 2 series of Ken Dodd's Palace of Laughter, and 8 episodes of For Better or Worse.
Can you hear me, Mother?
We certainly can. Open the doors for Sue Pollard. Sue, you played Paula's daughter. Did you ever stop for a quiet chat?
First choir with us two. Typhoon twosome. Do you remember one incident, right? Your friend, it was her birthday. So armed with a box of chocolates, you duly got in the car and you thought, she'll love these chocolates. So about 10 minutes later, there she was in the driving seat, and there were the chocolates on the passenger seat. And suddenly, the left hand found its way to the passenger seat. And sure enough, there was 5 chocolates left. So the friend never got these chocolates. So the next day, she gets in the car again with yet another box of chocolates. She thought, right, this is it. I'm going to put them in the boot. just put your fabulous chocolates in the car boot, and sure, there she was. Everything was going brilliantly, you know, 10 minutes down the motorway, and suddenly, oh, I think I've got a slight pang. So she pulled into a lay-by, and the boot died, and let the chocolates go. So your poor friend, all she was left with was a few pathetic chocolate wrappings and the pictures of what they should have looked like. Anyway, it's been absolutely fantastic, and I hope the rest of your evening goes with a bang.
Now, by the end of the 1980s, you're a familiar face on television. In 1987, you play Flo, the downtrodden wife, in a series of Andy Capp. Then in 1990, you're on Coronation Street as Mrs. Barford, the woman who tries to win the heart of Alf Roberts. In 1994, you crossed the Pennines into Yorkshire to join Emmerdale as the resident gas bag. And one of your close friends in the cast was one of the victims of the coach crash that devastated the village. But perhaps it was all a dream, because he's here tonight. Butch Dingle, oh, alias Paul Loughran. Well, now you can tell the truth, can't you? What is she really like?
She is an absolute nightmare. As Paula knows well, I'm pretty grumpy in the mornings, and if you can picture the scene, driving rain in the Yorkshire Dales, 7 o'clock in the morning, bacon butty in one hand, coffee in the other, and I'm not in the best of moods. And this little voice will always appear behind me, "All right, chuckles!" And it's her, and you just can't be in a bad mood. Paula, darling, you are a breath of fresh air.
Oh, bless you.
You're a wonderful person, you're a brilliant, brilliant friend, and you're a superb actress, and I love you.
Oh, I love you too.
Paul, thank you.
Bless you.
Before we close, we're going to turn the clock back nearly a quarter of a century to 1976, when you starred in the play Summer Season. You're a landlady giving board and lodgings to an end-of-pier comic, a gift of a part for our end-of-show spot. Paul Shane.
How are you, Chuck?
Are you all right?
Yes, Chuck.
Good memories, Paul.
She was fantastic. I mean, this wonderful lady was cast as Auntie B, and you were fantastic. I mean, I was a club act. I was a new boy on the block, and I learnt so much off you, kid, without you knowing. And I'll tell you this, and this is from the heart. Everybody said it. All I can say, Michael, is this lady is the finest lady that God put breath into. That's all I can say. I love you very much,
love
and
you,
I'll see
Paul.
You later.
Bless you. Mm-hmm. Looking forward to it. Looking forward to it.
Paul Tilbrook.
Living a lie's not easy for a castaway. Michelle Collins stars in new drama 2,000 Acres of Sky in 40 minutes on BBC One after the Changing Rooms team changing jobs. Next.